You mind if I have my cup of tea? Or
yeah, that's all right. No, okay. You can have a cup of tea. This is Rozalla Miller enjoying a cuppa underneath this. Well, we had a look around.
Lovely.
There's these horrible, like, toilet vehicles that are doing the rounds. There's a very, very muddy golf truck.
Oh,
I'm not sure what it is. But yeah, it's not
it's
very
like
pretty when you're backstage. So it's like the prettiest. Yeah. Well, the prettiest thing is sitting next to me, of course.
Thank you. Thank you. He's so lovely. Thank you.
So you're kind of back, because I remember all of those big hits were, and we've already had this conversation, like 1996, 97, 98.
Right.
And then suddenly you were telling me that you decided that you were going to tour to jazz. How does that happen?
Oh, that was a dream of mine, a dream come true. I recorded an easy listening jazz album called Broken Stones, and we released it 2009. And I got lucky to support Billy Ocean and did 53 dates with him. So it's unlike any of my dance material, and we decided to call it Rozalla Miller because everybody knows me by Rozalla. So we wanted to take it away from the dance. Everybody associates the name Rozalla with dance music. So my manager said, let's call it Rozalla Miller. And that's what I used to be called in Zimbabwe, Rozalla Miller. And years later, it stuck. So now it's Rozalla Miller.
So at what point did you come over from Zimbabwe?
I started traveling to United Kingdom late 1988.
Okay.
And I began to live here 1990. I just came purely just to do music.
Okay, because those were difficult times really in Zimbabwe.
Yeah, no, not at the time, they weren't. They absolutely were, it was wonderful.
Oh,
it started getting difficult, I would say 2008. So I'd long been living here by then.
Right.
Yeah.
And tell me a little bit about when it comes to, and I'm going to say that Everybody's Free has got to be one of my favourite tracks of all time. So, you just doing the vocals over that? Are you doing the production? How do you kind of go about building a track like that?
Oh gosh, well, at the time when I came to England, I was looking for a record deal. And I was sending around, at the time we had cassettes. Am I showing my age now? But anyway, so we were sending around cassettes to record labels trying to get me a deal. And then the one particular cassette got into the hands of what the guys that were known as a band of gypsies, and they loved my voice. They wanted to meet me. They said, we've got some great tracks for your voice that'll suit you. What do you want to do? I said, I want to do some really pumping dance tracks that when people hear them, they're not going to want to sit down. They want to stand up and dance. That's what they want to do. They're going to want to do. And I want the songs and the lyrics to be positive and uplifting. And then I went to the studio the one time, and Nigel wrote these words. Everybody's Free. He says, just go into the booth and start singing this over and over. And I started singing, Everybody's Free to Feel Good. It's like, yeah, keep on, keep on. And we recorded this over and over until we got a chorus. And Nigel said, we've got a chorus, and now let's start working on the lyrics and give it a story, you know. And again, it comes back to me telling them, I want it to be uplifting, you know, about brothers and sisters. And Tim and Nigel delivered that for me.
That's really spine tingling,
yeah.
Because especially from the fact that you said, okay, well, I want you to write some pumping dance tracks.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you're talking about, was it 1996? There wasn't pumping dance tracks out before that. It was all indie bands.
Yeah.
So it was Britpop. And I suppose at the late end of the 80s, there was all of that Kraftwerk kind of new order
of
stuff. So there was always guitars involved. So that kind of era was the first time that we heard pumping dance tracks that
different.
Didn't have a guitar in it.
No, it was different. It was... A lot of it was piano based, you know, some really hard bass. I love bass. I have to have bass in my, boom, boom, boom. I love it. And it just so happened that Tim and Nigel were doing that stuff. And then they found me, the vocalist, to front the songs they were writing at the time. And it just worked.
How big is your sound system then?
Massive. massive.
All right. So you haven't got any neighbors?
Well, what we've discovered, my husband's like, you got to get some earphones. So I need to watch my ears, obviously.
Oh.
But we've got these.
So you're upsetting your husband with the
plant
bass.
I'm upsetting somebody. But, what can you do? But, it's all good.
So you love bass and you love jazz. How did that happen?
Sometimes there's only so much I can...
You get cloth-eared?
Yeah, listening to dance tracks time and time again. And I've always loved the easy listening stuff, you know, and... it's something I've always wanted to do.
It's like light and shade, isn't it, I guess?
It's just light and shade, exactly. The yin and the yang, or whatever you want to call it, night and day. And I just always wanted to do some easy listening stuff because as a singer, I felt, I can do ballads. I can do the more easy listening tempo type of tracks. And I got the opportunity to do that, and I did it.
Wow. And I'm just trying to think how big that track, because the thing with British dance music, and I've explained this before, is that the whole world kind of got loads of other music genres. A lot of hip-hop came over from America. America was kind of obsessed with country music, yeah, which the rest of the world didn't. Yeah. So dance didn't travel all that well out of England.
No, it didn't.
What about you? Did you manage to get your tracks out?
When I went to America to start promoting Everybody's Free, Faith in the Power of Love, I was doing interviews at radio stations, and they've got categories at radio stations for the different styles and types of music they played, and there was nothing for dance music. There was nothing, and they just couldn't really understand my stuff, but they loved Everybody's Free, and I did quite a few big TV shows, but it just didn't catch on until many years later, which was just strange. And there was just a lot of country and western radio stations, a lot of easy listening stations, no dance music.
Well,
they've only just discovered it was alien, and so I think I was an alien as well.
All right.
But you know, hopefully I planted something there, because it's, you know, the tree is growing as far as I'm concerned.
And I suppose for any young aspiring singer, you know, you've got such powerful vocals. I'm guessing you're always kind of responding to people saying to you, oh, I want to follow in your footsteps and stuff like that.
Thank you very much. I find that an honor. And when people say what you just say, I just think, wow, because I was one of those people that mm-hmm. looked at artists, and I still do till today, where I think they've inspired me, you know, not necessarily dance artists. As a child growing up, I loved listening to Barbara Streisand. Her voice is incredible. Mm. I love listening to the Carpenters. I loved Dinah Ross, and I got the fortune of meeting Dinah Ross. I loved listening to the Jacksons and Michael Jackson, and I ended up, thank you, I'm not names dropping, supporting Michael Jackson in 1992 for his Dangerous tour.
How was that?
Incredible. Absolutely. That was, for me, will remain the highlight of my career.
I can imagine.
Yeah, that will remain the highlight of my career, to have supported Michael Jackson on about, I think it was about 42 or 43 European stadium gigs, and performing in front of all these thousands of people was just incredible. You know, I doubt if I'll ever get the opportunity to perform in front of 75,000 people, or in Paris, they burnt the gates down and they ended up being 100,000 people.
I talk about living the dream. You know, so many people would be like, I want that to be me.
It's amazing. It's amazing. My husband makes me laugh. I shouldn't really say this, but when we go and watch other artists, my husband's like, that artist is really good, but they didn't support Michael Jackson, did they?
Or Billy Ocean.
Or Billy Ocean.
Who else have you supported?
That's about it, really.
Okay. All right. Well, what an incredible time that you've had.
It's been amazing.
What advice would you give to anyone who's just setting out in their career now?
I would say, because, you know, when I first started out, I found it tough. I still find it tough. I think it's a tough industry to be in. And people think I went through it easy, because it's even tougher now. And I can see that in some ways, it's so much tougher. But like anything in life, never give up. Follow your dreams, follow your heart. If you feel it deep down in here, follow your dreams. Never, never give up. And you'll get people who will be like, oh, just throw it in, it's over. No, no, no. You know in here, you just know.
Hey, we could talk for hours, but I'll tell you what, the festival organizers said 10 minutes. I'm sure we've done more than 10 minutes now.
We've been warned.
I'm getting a nod. So before I get dragged off by security, we're going to wrap it up there. And it's been a real pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. Thank you, guys.